I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves.
All right, folks, it is post-game therapy hour with the Wolfpack Red White Podcast. I'm your host, Evan. On the couch today with me, Matt Coe. Matt, that was maybe not our best performance. What are you thinking right now?
Well, starters, thanks for having me on again. I had a lot of fun last time, and it's good to be back, even in a disappointing loss. Yeah, that was ugly, man. There's no other way to put it. What'd you think?
Yeah. You know, I think, and this is going to get dark real quick, but I know FSU shot lights out, and they did. I mean, that was their historic performance, right? There was historically their most, their highest offensive efficiency game ever. The last time they were more effective than that was 2001 against Campbell. So with that being said, I think the reality is setting in that this team is average at best. And it pains me to say that because the league is down. The league's not very good. The opportunity was there. I feel like we've had this story before, but, you know, given not just this game, but the Miami game, the Clemson game, you know, even the BC game, you can make, you know, somebody made a point that BC could make the argument they should have won that game. And to me, it's coming down to, I think it's apparent that they're not very good. And I just, I hope I'm wrong, but I didn't feel like it, man. I don't think so. I think this is, we got our hopes up a little too high early on. And, you know, the reality is starting to set in.
Yeah. I'm going to try to be a little optimistic as best as I can. So after the Clemson game, you know, we talked, we recorded an episode, and we did have our hopes high. I think a lot of NC State fans had their hopes pretty high. And so it's weird because they played so well in that Clemson game. And that's why I was so frustrated because we could have won that game. Then you go lose to Miami without their two starters. And I wasn't really mad at that game at all. I wasn't really in panic mode just because we really weren't in that game ever. it was pretty ugly all the way through. And then you go to Florida State and you get, in lack for better terms, just demolished. There's no other way to put it. I think this is their second highest point total since 1993 against Wake Forest, where they scored 111 points. And if you want to put that into context, nobody on that FSU roster was even alive at that point. So, you really have to go back, you know? So, yeah, I mean, I still don't think it's panic time, but you're definitely not feeling good, like, at all. I hated what I saw effort wise. And that's where it's time to be really frustrated is when you see guys, you know, kind of like, I saw your tweet, kind of like Olaying on defense, just kind of letting them blow by. And that's frustrating, man, because you never want to see a team give up, no matter the score. And I don't think that they cared to even try to get back in the game. I mean, you're right. They shot, 71% to close out the game. They were shooting 71% at the half, so they didn't even slow down at all. I do think it's a little bit of both. You know, bad defensive play and just amazing offensive play. I guess if you want to say there's some good that came out of this, I mean, we shot the ball well. I mean, outside of that, I don't really know what else. Thomas Allen, another game high.
Yeah.
So,
you know, that my LA tweet was in reference to this. It was in the second half in particular. And this is it was Jericho Helms. But he wasn't the only one that was doing it. Is that they let the guy go by him, and then they try to reach around and poke the ball out from behind. And I see that over and over again, and I hate it.
It's lazy.
It drives me crazy. It's lazy. Yeah, it's exactly right. It's lazy.
Yeah.
And it's super frustrating to watch, you know, just to see that. And, you know, Keats had a comment after the game. I was trying to scroll back through and find. He said two things. One, he said, shit, man. They shot the heck out of the ball. I think that's what he said. Let me find the exact quote.
Yeah, because I haven't seen any of his quotes yet, so this is all new to me.
Yeah. He said, shit, man, they shot the hell out of the basketball. So I appreciate the candor, and I appreciate the non-coach speak. But he also said, I thought we were mentally locked in. Both teams had 2 3-pointers to start off. We started missing them, and they kept making them. I thought mentally we came into the game ready to play. Now, that might be true, but that didn't last more than a couple minutes. And like you said, I think it was apparent that they didn't believe they could fight back, right? They didn't believe they could come back in there. When just last week, I forgot who it was. Somebody was down 20 at halftime and ended up winning by 36. It might have been Michigan or one of those Big Ten schools. Like, you can come back and win on these games if you try. And it didn't feel like they were engaged that second half at all. And I don't know, man. Like,
well, I like what you said. I want to build off of what you said. How you said Keats said that we were mentally prepared when we hit those first 2 threes.
And again,
this is the first time I'm seeing it, so I'm taking it at face value. That really pisses me off, to be honest. We led for 32 seconds. So if you're okay with being locked in for 32 seconds, I mean, good for you, I guess, but go play, you know, YMCA basketball over there. That's frustrating to hear. That sucks.
Wow. You know, the first drive of the game, Devin Daniels drives into the lane, penetrates. He stops at the free throw line. He kicks it out to Helms. Helms is a three. And I was like, holy crap, this is going to be a different team, right? Daniels passed the ball. Helms hit a three early. Like, the things were – all the things we complained about before, like, were starting to fall in line. I was like, oh, man, this is it. And then they just could not handle shot after shot, pun intended, from FSU.
Yeah.
And to me, where I felt it was disconnected was the offensive game plan. I'm not exactly sure what the offensive game plan was, but it felt like it was either shoot a lot of threes, which I figured that would be if Manny Bates isn't playing. You know, it's kind of your game plan against a tall FSU team. Or drive it in and just turn the ball over or something. Like, you know, driving into the trees. FSU's got a huge lineup. And it just felt like repeatedly we were going, just driving into the lane, just to go nowhere.
Yeah.
And I don't know, man. I wasn't even frustrated after this game. I just don't think they're good. Like, I don't think they have enough good players yet. And you have some players, but I think, you know, Shaq Moore's young, Cam's young, and Daniels isn't Devin Daniels that we thought he would get from, you know, a senior. DJ didn't have a very good game. I'm looking at the plus minus, right? If you're into that, into the box scores.
I am. I like it.
All right, listen to these plus minuses. DJ Funderburk, minus 23. Shaq Moore, minus 26. Cam Hayes, minus 12. Jericho Helms, minus 31. Devin Daniels, minus 29. Like, that's your starting five. That's maybe your best five players. Thomas Allen, minus 11.
Like, was Thomas Allen terrible. Was Thomas Allen the highest in the plus minus?
Well, Farrar got a minute, and he was 2. And then EB got a minute, and he was 3.
I love Nick Farrar. You know, his passion to be there, it's great. But when Nick Farrar is,
Nick Farrar's on the floor. That's not a good day.
Yeah.
FSU put in their walk-ons with 6 minutes left in the game. If that tells you anything.
And I mean, you should be pissed off if you're NC State. I mean, you had fans, you know, yelling air ball and they have 100 points on the board. You know, like, why are you even there? Yeah. Why are you there? Go home. All right. Game's over. but seriously, like, if you want, we can go. We don't have to go through every player, but I do want to talk about specific players. So, like, I'll start off with Devin Daniels. Devin Daniels, now, I don't know if that stat holds up after this game, but going into this game, he's leading our team in assists. at, I believe, 3.3. He had three in this game. And this is a guy that we're talking about as a ball hog, is a guy that, you know, a lot of ISO ball and all that. And that's your leading assist. That's a problem. That's a big problem. You know, and he didn't even get his, I actually wrote this down. He didn't get his first made field goal till 5:30 left in the first. And at that point, you know, maybe he's having a rough shooting night. Let me see what he shot. He shot 2 for 6 in the game. In the first half.
12.
Yeah, sorry. In the first half, he was 2 for 6. I mean, if he's going to be our scorer, because this is the thing I kept hearing after the Miami game is, you know, we don't have an X factor. We don't have a go-to guy. And that's fair. That's true. We probably don't. And I know Markell Johnson's game helped out Devin Daniels a lot. But another guy I want to talk about is Jericho Helms. I think losing Jericho Helms late in games, you know, like the Clemson game and the Miami game, it messes up the flow. He is the grease, you know, that turns the bolts and the engine goes. And no, he's not an X factor, but when you take him out, all right, now what do you do with that four spot? He's our small ball power forward and our best one. So, and Keith's system runs through that small ball lineup. So you can't play DJ and Manny together. It just doesn't work. And Manny didn't play in this game, so it was a matchup nightmare from the get-go. And obviously it was all night. But Darian Sebron, even though he's skinny, he's tall, he's athletic, he's lengthy, you could maybe plug him in there. What did Daniels have rebound total? Let me see here. Daniels had,
I got the box open.
Yeah, I got it right here.
He had one rebound.
One rebound. And this is one of the best, you know, rebounding guards in the ACC. So you can't put him at the four. So now you have a gaping hole when Jericho Helms is not on the floor. And there's not much you can do. So I don't know if this team needs an X factor, just maybe somebody to back up Jericho, or if Jericho can stay on the floor. Thomas Allen, you know, another guy I want to touch on. How does he not have set up plays for him?
Right. You know, he got some heat early on. Allen was 6 for 8, 4 for 5 from three, had 16 points. He had the best plus minus. If Sebron had the best plus minus, but he didn't play enough minutes. Allen played 23 minutes. He was plus minus 11, minus 11.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, he's tentative still, right? He still doesn't seem to be aggressive for, you know, for a shooter. That's what we were told. He's a shooter. He passes up a lot of threes, but still, I mean, God, he was efficient tonight. 6 for 8, 4 for 5 from three. Like, he needs the ball more. He needs more shots.
Yeah, and if he's going to be your X factor, that's fine. I'm okay with that. I mean, this is a – I don't even think he's just a shooter. I think he's just a straight-up, you know, scorer. This is a guy that can score inside and outside. So I'd like to see him go into Georgia Tech and be hungry for the ball. Get your Devin Daniels on, all right? Don't pass. just put up shots, man, because you're right now you're playing the best ball on the team as far as offense goes. You know, screw it. Go in there with some confidence. I will say I was excited to see Cam and Shaquille start together. And the reason being is because they are going to start together, you know, for years to come. So they need to learn how to play together. But with that said, I know Cam didn't have a very good game. Shaq did have that
3 for 11 for Cam, 3 for 10 for Shaq.
Yeah. And like Shaq had that cool dunk, but we were down by so much, I couldn't even enjoy it. So,
right.
It was crap from the get-go. I know you guys touched on it. I think it was in your last episode or maybe the episode before, how Keats needs to play players with fouls and how he sits them.
Yes.
DJ Fundenberg not playing in the last 7 minutes with two fouls. Yeah. We're already undersized. Why is he not in there?
I don't know. Yeah. There's so much to unpack with this game. Like, just going through this box score real quick, 19 total rebounds, that's embarrassing. I know FSU shot well, but you only got 19 rebounds. FSU had 32. That's not good, man. That's not good.
But, I mean, I'm not surprised that we got out-rebounded by Florida State had it even been closer. I would pick Florida State because they're big, they're tall, they're athletic.
I agree, but the total number is not good.
Oh yeah, no, it's awful. Yeah, it's definitely awful. Another thing is the turnovers. If Keats is, and I like his system, you know, forcing turnovers, but if you're relying on the other team to make mistakes so that you can benefit from it, I don't know how far that's going to get you, because if the team's not making mistakes, then you're not taking advantage of their non-mistakes. I mean, we did in the first half. We had 7 turnovers to their 4, 0 points off of turnovers to their 10. We closed out the game evenly, you know, 11 apiece turnover wise, but points off turnovers 9-16. So it's just like if that's Keats' bread and butter, that's his thing, and that's what he sells. And if you can't even do the thing that you do best and you're known for, what are we looking at?
Right. I don't know where the ball pressure is. They pride themselves on being able to play defense and get turnovers to get easy transition buckets. You know, they didn't get that. I mean, Florida State had 24 assists, 11 turnovers. State had 10 assists, 11 turnovers. We weren't turning them over. And we've seen that in these other games too. Where's the pressure? This is what he excels at, is getting his team out and running. And when they don't do that, I think this is the product of that. Right, this is what you see. I'm looking at these total numbers, right? So here's Florida State's shooting percentage, 70%. Right, they're 41-58 in the game for 70%, 12-18 from 3, 11-11 from free throw line. They shot the ball really well, and State didn't shoot the ball bad. If you look at it, they were 44% from the field, 42% from 3. You know, that's 40%, you know, 42% and then 75% from
the
free throw line.
They were shooting 50 from the 3 at half and 48 from the field at half. So it's like,
right,
you got to feel good going into that, you know. But obviously the score it was pretty lopsided.
I was just going to say, when you don't play any defense, that's kind of what happens, man. Yeah. Fast break points, Florida State had 27 fast break points. Points in the paint, Florida State had 52 points in the paint.
Yeah,
like that's not good, and that's what makes me real, like, makes me think about it. you just don't have the players. They're not old enough. Like, there's all the pieces aren't there, despite what we thought, right? The young guys are still young. They're going to have these games. We knew that. You know, freshman guards in the ACC have these kind of games.
Yeah,
but you can't have a game like this from Devin Daniels, where he's a non-factor, and Jericho Helms, where he's, you know, minus 31 plus minus.
But this isn't even like a game for Devin Daniels. This is now a stretch. This is multiple games in a row. This is not just like he had a bad game, whatever. No, this is a thing, you know? And so if Devin Daniels is going to struggle like this and Thomas Allen is going to play as well as he is, I mean, I know you don't want to, but maybe you force your hand and have to put Devin coming off the bench, because outside of Thomas Allen, you're not getting any kind of consistent offense.
Yeah, I agree. And I think, you know, one of the things I saw with the offense, it felt like a lot of times to me that we have a lot of guys that are driving to score instead of driving to create. And what I mean by that is they're not creating for others. So we knew Devin Daniels does it, right? But the other guys seem to be doing it as well. And I think that explains why you have 10 assists on the night. You know, you're just not creating for anybody else. Cam Hayes had 5 assists. He was doing that a little bit more. But the other guys are just – there's something not gelling with this team and with the flow there. And I think that is – Keats has some work to do. That's a big issue.
Yeah. Yeah, it's frustrating hearing you, because I don't disagree with you when you say, you know, we just don't have the guys this year, because I don't, and it's obvious right now that they're not playing like it. But the potential, man, it's like this team really does have the potential to be one of the best defensive teams in the ACC, and then they go out and give up, you know, almost a record to Florida State, and
yeah,
it's just what are we doing, you know? The Miami game. I mean, they're not even good defensively, and they shut us down. And I've become used to it now. I'm accustomed to it. Keats has these moments in games where the team just struggles on offense. And I don't know if it's because they're tired from running up and down the court and, you know, throwing up lazy shots or whatever the case may be. You know, we haven't had a bona fide for sure sharp shooting three type of guy. Maybe that is doing it. I don't know, but the defense should never be a question with Cam Hayes, who isn't bad. You've got Manny Bates, the best shot blocker in the nation. Devin Daniels, one of the best on-ball defenders in the ACC. Shaquille Moore, one of the best on-ball defenders in the ACC. Jericho's, you know, athletic enough to you know, get to his man or sidestep. Defense should not be a question with this team. And the fact that we just gave up 100, man, yeah, that's
105.
Bad. That's bad. That's bad, yeah. Dude. But hey, I mean, if you want to be positive, if you want to be more of a half glass half full kind of guy, the offense looked better than the Miami game. But
you know that Miami game, and I might have said this in chat. I don't remember if I said it on a pod yet. But I'm concerned that Miami game was our canary in the coal mine.
Mm-hmm.
Miami just got trucked by BC.
Dude, 22 points. BC. What the heck, yeah. Man?
Trucked by BC. And we made Miami look competent.
Yeah.
And to me, that's like I'm starting to put the pieces together. The last three games, you know, they're the transitive property of basketball. What is happening elsewhere in the league? And I'm like, we're not as good as I thought we were.
Yeah. We're declining as far as teams inclined. Look at Carolina. They started off terrible. They're starting to come back. Duke starting to come back. Now they did lose to Virginia Tech, but Virginia Tech is legit. I mean, they're a top three. So
like it's, you know, you put these things to, you put all these pieces together and that's kind of where I am. I do think there is potential, but he is not getting it out of him right now.
Mm-mm.
And I think, I don't know if he's got to be more creative with his lineups or like you said, you know, hey, Devin, you need to sit for a minute and like chill out. You need to sit, come off the bench and, you know, watch your other teammates play. Yeah. Like, I don't think, here's the thing. I think, you know, you mentioned not having a real sharpshooter. Like I'm confident Braxton can shoot. I'm confident Thomas Allen can shoot. The thing is that nobody is creating for these guys. To me, it just seems like, you know, you can't rely on Braxton to get his own shot, right? He's not big enough. That's a fact. And you're not driving and kicking. And I think these guys aren't playing to help one another out. And, you know, the term hero ball is thrown around a lot. I don't know if it's hero ball. It's just, it's not, you know, basketball. It's not, they're not passing the ball. They're not, like, engage with one another.
I don't think it's a chemistry thing.
Maybe they're trying too hard. Maybe they're pressing, right? Because they, you know, everybody wants to be the hero.
Yeah.
I feel like you see that a lot from Jericho and Devin Daniels. And you need those guys to be better. You need those guys to get everybody else involved.
Yeah.
And they're not.
Well,
I think,
I'm sorry for cutting you off. I think going into the season, the consensus around NC State was if NC State's going to excel, it's going to be because of Jericho Helms. I think Jericho Helms was the key factor because you want to see that step. You want to see that improvement in his junior year. I think he's played well, you know, for the most part all year. But his issue is staying on the court. And like I said, it just goes back to style of play. You know, Keats has not had a whole lot of fortunate luck when it comes to players staying and going for the draft or just unfortunate situations. So he's had his hands, you know, tied, you know what I'm saying? So Jericho has to be the guy because there is no other guy. Darian Sebron has not given you anything. You can't put Devin there right now. It's that, or you go with Manny and DJ. And we've seen that it just doesn't work. And it sucks because DJ, our best lineup is with Jericho at the four and Manny at the five. But the problem is that DJ, in my opinion, is our best player. And if your best player is coming off the bench, I think this team right now has an identity crisis and nobody is really stepping up. Cam's supposed to be this pass first kind of guy, but don't forget that he likes to score and he can score. But as we're seeing, freshman point guards struggle in the ACC.
Right. My thing with Jericho is he played all the whole pretty much the whole game, 34 minutes tonight. Yeah. And he wasn't really in foul trouble, but I don't think he knows when to put it in his pocket, right? Put the guns in the holster and get somebody else involved. He started out good, started missing some shots. Then he ended up 5 for 11, throwing up a couple of air balls at the end of the game. You know, I'm with you. He's got to get everybody else involved. He feels like that energy piece, right? He's always trying to get guys going, and he needs to get guys going. He needs to help them do that, and not just try to do that by putting the ball in the basket himself.
Yeah. Because he's going to be Devin leader Daniels next year.
Is not going to do that.
No, yeah. Not at all. Yeah, I mean, Jericho's going to be the leader next year. Everybody's going to be looking for Jericho to be the guy. I mean, because Devin's out, DJ's out. It's going to be Manny and Jericho. It was a bad game. It was. And, you know, the Miami game was a bad game. I said after that game, throw the tape away, forget about it. This game, you can't really do that. You can't have back-to-back games where you throw the tape out because now you're just forgetting all your bad games. I mean, they had guys making pull-up half-court shots. Like,
yeah,
you know, it was their night. But at the same time, we did not do ourselves any favors. I just don't know if Devin Daniels isn't putting up 20 to 24 or DJ's putting up, you know, 16 to 20. Like, who's scoring? Who's putting up buckets?
That's exactly it.
What are we doing?
We don't have the players. Like, you need 20 from two of the three guys, DJ, Cole, or Devin. Two of those three have to have 20 plus a night for this team to be good, because you're not going to get it from elsewhere. All right, maybe Thomas Allen, right? But put him in that bucket. But you're not going to get it from the other guys. They just don't have it. And then, you know, combine that with a hot shooting team, it's a bad recipe, man.
I think our defense relies on Manny way too much with the weak side help, because they know how great the shot blocker he is. And I think that was apparent in this one. They just kind of threw the towel, you know, because
poor Jalen Gibson.
Oh, dude, right. I mean, it was just that, though. They were just getting in there as easy as they could. So,
yeah,
I don't know where to go from here.
I don't either. You know, I'm not too upset. It's just kind of reality setting in. I'm frustrated like everybody else. I mean, this is a classic Wolfpack, you know, the being middle of the road. I got a feeling that's where they are until they prove me wrong.
Yeah, but I
want to be wrong.
I mean, OK, this is the thing. Like, I can agree. Maybe we don't have the guys just yet. But I think I'm also right when I say there's too much talent to be blown out by 30 or
agreed. Whatever. Yes, I agree. Yeah.
There's too much talent, and that shouldn't happen. Or giving up 100, you know, that just shouldn't happen. These types of games, like giving up 100 and so, that should happen to like a Wake Forest this year or a Boston College this year, you know, a team that we almost lost to. So it just really puts you into perspective. But I mean, look at our next three. We host Georgia Tech. We go to Virginia, and then we go to Carolina. I mean, after that Clemson loss, you know, we were feeling great. You know, we got a whole lot of backlash, 4-1 in the next five, possibly. Who knows? Because, I mean, when you see that lineup for Miami, you assume that's a win. But man, I'm not going to lie. I wouldn't be surprised if, I hate to say it, but a 6-game losing streak, maybe one win in this next three. I don't know, man.
If you look at the schedule going the rest of the way out, there's four, maybe five wins. Like, and those are maybes, right? All these games are 50-50s. All these teams, including us, are 6-4, 6-3. You know, Wake's terrible, but Syracuse 7-3. Everybody's about the same, right? Records wise. And I'm curious how this team is going to respond. And if they respond, you know, can they win some extra games? But, you know, right now there's not a whole lot of wins left on the schedule. And this team is – reality seems to be setting in that this team is just not very good.
Yeah, and, you know, I don't want to speak – for the tournament. I mean, that's another 2 months away. There's a lot of basketball to be played, so we'll see. But you go back to that year that we didn't make the tournament, even though we were, you know, number one as far as bubble teams in the net ranking, which the net ranking is a joke. And, you know, we had that 24-point game, but we were last in non-conference. Now, I don't think that that really had anything to do with the reason why we weren't in the tournament, seeing as Indiana had a terrible record, yet in the NIT, they were a higher rank than us just because they beat a couple of good teams. But if you do want to look into the future, into March, I think this is that 24-point game. This is that game that they look back and say, well, you lost to Miami without their two starters, two of their best players. You had a full roster. And then the very next game, you know, you let the other team put up triple digits. So now we've given the committee an argument. And it's going to be important to see how they answer back from that argument. Because if you want to forget about these losses, you know, you're going to have to go on some type of run. And I just don't see how they're going to set up some type of run.
I agree. I think that's probably a good place to leave it. Yeah. We got Georgia Tech coming up. Hang on, I got the schedule. Georgia Tech, Virginia, Carolina. Is that right?
Yeah.
I don't know what's going to happen. I want to see this team respond. I think there is talent on this team. You know, the young guys have to grow, and the old guys have to, you know, pull them along better than they are. And I just, you know, I want to see more from it. He's got a lot of work to do. I've said it a few times on Twitter. He's got a lot of work to do. I think that is really obvious.
We sound so deflated right now. We sound so defeated.
Oh, man. It is what it is, man. Like somebody asked in response earlier, you know, I forgot how they phrased it. Like at some point, like, why are we watching? I was like, it's entertainment to me, right? I don't get too upset about these things anymore.
Yeah. Go Pack.
I'm frustrated like everybody else, and it makes me question if I should put my money in. But for the most part, I'm still going to enjoy I'm still going to watch these games. I'm still going to enjoy it.
Yeah.
And I just want to see something better, man. Like everybody else, I just want a better product. I want to win. And I think the most frustrating thing of all, and this goes for all the sports, is seeing the opportunity there of seeing a league that is, you know, not very good, or you don't have Carolina and Duke dominating the top like we have before, and not being able to take advantage of it. Not being in position to take advantage of it. And it's tough, man. That's a tough one to swallow for me. But Georgia Tech's coming up. See if Keats can get that monkey off his back on Saturday. But that's all I got. You got anything else, Matt?
No, man. This is nut up time, you know, nut up or shut up. Yep. So this is the turning point. You know, if you're as good as you say, then show up. But I appreciate you having me on, man.
As always, thanks for listening. Go Pack. I was raised by the wolves.